Welcome to part 3 of the timer series. Here you can learn WPF and C#. First of all, let's update the timer's version. Secondly, let's make it possible to restore the window after hiding it to tray. Create a new event for clicking on notify icon in tray. When we click on the notify icon, we should make it invisible. Then we will show the program in the taskbar again. After that, we show our window. Finally, we change the window state to normal. It's time to program the state changed event. Although it's fired whenever we change the window state, we are interested only when it is minimized. If it is, we initialize our notify icon. A tooltip displayed when you hover over the notify icon is in the text property of it. And here is where we add our click event created before. In order to set the icon image, we will use stream and access our resource. Press Ctrl dot and hit Enter to include missing namespaces. To get the needed resource stream, we need to access the application class in system.windows namespace. The application class has a method called getResourceStream, which accepts URI as an argument. When you initialize a new URI, you need to pass a URI string to its constructor. This URI string is a path to the resource. IDEST pack colon 2/ application colon 3/ resources /timer.ico. GetResourceStream method returns stream resource info, which has a property called stream, and that's what we actually need. Also, don't forget to make the notify icon visible. And finally, you hide the window. Let's move on. Here we will just set all text boxes to pre-launch time values. Pretty simple. Now let's implement text box number validation. For proper validation, we will need a regular expression. First, you create and initialize a new regex, IDEST regular expression. In its constructor, you can type the expression. We allow only numbers from 0 to 9, so in square braces type 0-9. We should make it reverse, so it will match anything not in this group. To do this, just type caret before character group. Since we allow more than one character in our text boxes, type plus after the square braces, which means at least one time. If there is a match, it means that there was disallowed text, and we shouldn't let it through. Using the handled bool property, we can tell the program not to finish this event as it would. Because we preview text input, we thus can define what should be typed. Let's finish with validation, so open the onPrevewKeyDown event. Actually, we need it only because it's hard or even impossible to catch by a regular expression. I'm talking about the space key. We check if the pressed key is space. If it is, we handled the event as if space was never pressed. The final step for validation is the lost focus event. It occurs if you click anywhere outside of the text box. First, we check if the text was left empty. If it was, we should set it to a standard 00 view. Otherwise, if there is some text, because we caught any possible text changing event before, we can without a doubt set the new text. But just to be sure, let's convert the value to int and again return as a string, but in a standard format. Finally, we check if the value is greater than 59. For example, if the user types 70. If so, we decrease it to 59. All these steps were needed to just recreate the base functionality of a numeric up-down. At last, we can work on sound notifications. This is very easy. We just need to check which radio button is checked and play the appropriate sound. Instead of implementing the whole sound logic here, we will call relevant methods instead. It's a good practice to break unrelated code blocks into separate methods. Press Ctrl dot on each inexistent method to automatically generate it. Also, it's a good opportunity to learn how to create methods with parameters. Console beeps are your hardware beeps. You can play them even without loudspeakers or headphones. We are going to have three series of three consecutive beeps, nine in total. The first loop is for series. Usually your loop looks like this. You declare an index starting with 0, set the limit after the first semicolon, and set the step after the second semicolon. But I want to show you a non-typical way to create for loops, which can sometimes be more apparent from the first glance. You can set the needed number of times while declaring the variable. Then the limit will be just bigger than 0. It works only if you change the step to be negative. In order to play a beep, you access the console class, call the beep method. In braces, you specify frequency and duration in milliseconds. Then, after we play three beeps, we can make a pause by accessing the thread class and calling its sleep method. In braces, you set the pause time again in milliseconds. After that, I will play another beep, but this time with a higher frequency and longer duration. Finally, I will add a half a second pause before the next series of beep starts. That was console or hardware beep. The rest of the sounds are going to be system sounds. The operating system also has a system sound called beep, though it is different from the hardware counterpart. I will use that unusual loop format again. This time we need to access the system sounds class. Then its beep property, and then call the play method. Let's add a medium pause after each system beep. Next, let's play the exclamation sound. Again, there will be three series. In each series, there will be three consecutive sounds. Let's add the fourth sound. Now it's time for asterisk, just like before, but even simpler. And finally, the hand sound. Unlike previous methods, this one has a parameter that we need to pass to it when we call this method. First, let's rename the auto-generated name to something more meaningful. So, when you call this method, you are able to specify the number of times it should play. Let's put it in the loop. Unlike previous loops, the number of times it will run depends now on the passed parameter. Let's try a different number. Okay, time to sum up. In this tutorial, you learned how to use system and hardware sounds, tray and regular expressions. You also made a timer program with an optional second timer. In the next tutorials, you will learn how to generate and use license keys and hashing for software protection, make your program multilingual, automatically detect the language, use third-party controls, make custom fancy draggable windows, work with the registry and fade windows.